Start.
All right. thank you very much, Surup, and others, Santosh, everybody else, for letting me in. Good morning. This is Ajit Kebabi from Ayuka, and I'm going to be talking to you today on big data, machine learning, and deep learning in astronomy. Now, this is a very general kind of title, and so let me first tell you what I'll be doing over a course of 3 lectures. So first, I will introduce you to data in astronomy. I mean, how do we gather data? What do you mean by big data? And how is this data useful? So then the second part would be a talk on machine learning and deep learning. So I'm sure that you'll all be familiar with these concepts, but nevertheless, I will introduce them from applications and astronomy point of view. And then I'll give you a couple of examples of applications. And these will be something that we have been working on with a group of people in Ayuka and in other places in India and all over the world. Then the part 3 of my talk will be on precision measurements in astronomy. So you see that when we generally talk about measurements in astronomy, there's a feeling that this cannot be very accurate because we cannot construct experimental situations and make measurements as we please. Astronomers are observers. Astronomy is an observational science. And the objects are all very far away. And then they behave according to their whims and fancies, and we cannot get them to do what we like when we like. And therefore, the measurements can sometimes be less accurate than in other experiments in physics. Nevertheless, over the years, astronomers have learned to make very accurate measurements. And I will demonstrate to you through a few specific examples about how precise these observations can be. And in fact, using these observations, it is possible now to define a clock, an astronomical clock, which could be as accurate as the best clock which is available on Earth now. So now I'm looking upon these 3 parts of my lecture. They obviously will be mixed together quite a lot. There'll be a certain amount of repetition. And it is not that one part will cover one day. And we'll just see how we get there as we go along. Unfortunately, this is not a situation where I can see my audience. And that it's a truly hard thing, because just imagine and you're going to a performance, and then a musical performance, and then you are looking at the performer. But even more importantly for the performance, the performer is looking at you. So if everybody just gives their mind downstairs, then the performer finishes fast and just go home. On the other hand, if there is what is known as dark, if people respond, and if people respond positively, the performance gets better and better. It's the same for speakers, because we are very much dependent upon reactions from the audience to temper our lectures. I mean, I can make out from your eye movements and your yawning and smiling as to how the lecture is going, and I can hope to correct it. Unfortunately, that facility is not available here. Nor do we have the facility of asking questions during the lecture. But maybe if you have a longer set of lectures, that can also be arranged. Hopefully we'll come to that as the technology will keep improving. So now before I proceed further, I'd just like to acknowledge collaborations with a large group of people. In fact, some are missing from here. And Nidhan Sajid Philip is a senior a machine learning expert from Kerala with whom I've been collaborating for 25 years, and it goes on like that. Some of these have been students, some of these have been postdocs. Some of them were students and postdocs, but are now senior faculty. So it goes on. So we get together in various subgroups and work on different problems. Now there's a parallel set of people with whom I've been working for the last couple of years who are all biologists, and we apply AI to biological investigations. So I will not be covering that in this set of lectures that I have. All right, so we come to big data in astronomy. And so let's see what we mean by big data. Now, things like big data, big telescope, precise measurements, these are all concepts which evolve with time. So as you all know, it was Galileo who started first using a telescope for astronomical purposes. Then he made his own wonderful telescopes. They had an objective diameter of about 1 inch. And they were used to make the most wonderful discoveries. Okay, that completely changed the nature of science, caused a lot of trouble on the other fronts, on the social fronts, and set the pace for astronomy of the future. Right, so when Galileo was using his telescope, which we now consider to be small even for a family use, then his telescope was the biggest telescope in the world. And therefore, he made the most wonderful discoveries and the most impactful, the greatest impact was caused by the fact that he realized that around Jupiter, there were the moons. So these are objects which had never been thought of before. And then when he pointed his telescope at the Milky Way, he resolved it into hundreds of thousands of stars. So there was much more than you could see with the naked eye. And that has always been the case when you develop new telescopes. You're looking for new phenomena, and then the data keeps coming in. At any given moment, the data is overwhelming, meaning that there is always too much data for you to analyze. And then you typically, as you go to a new telescope and new data sets, you need to invent new methods. Right in Galileo's time, he did all his calculations by hand. He did not know many of the notions or cherished notions were not available at the time. And yet, wonderful conclusions could be drawn from the data. So I want to describe this by looking at one particular very simple kind of data. Okay, meaning that the simplest objects that we see in the sky are the stars, right? Because they're just where they are, they're twinkling, and then there are the constellations which help to guide the eye. And the most basic measurements you could make on these stars is to try to measure their positions. Where are they in the sky? Do they really remain there? I mean, year after year, you see the constellation of the Ursa Major having the same shape. But is there a motion of the stars in that particular constellation at some small scale? And then how bright are the stars? Now, with the naked eye, you can see about 4,000 stars in the sky. And then if it's a clear night, if your eye is very good and you're a keen observer, then you can see many more stars. And you can see more stars, people who are not good observers will see fewer stars and so on, but the average number is about 4,000. So there were many astronomers in different parts of the world in ancient times who were making measurements on positions and brightnesses. But the one person who did it really thoroughly, maintained good records, and in some sense published his observations and used observations which had been done before his time, was Hipparchus. Okay, now unfortunately, I have to keep moving this thing around here. I can't see. One moment. Yeah, so Hipparchus, he carried out his observations around 150 BC, right? So that about 2,200 years before our time. And he made a careful catalog of stars, and his catalog had in it 1,000 stars. Right, so you can see that in the upper left corner of the diagram before you. And there you see that the positions were known to within about 1,000 arc seconds. I'm sure all of you know that a degree is 60 arc minutes and 3,600 arc seconds. So 1,000 arc seconds is an accuracy of about 1/3 of a degree. And he had 1,000 stars in his catalog. He also made notes about the brightness, that there are all these five brightness classes and so forth. Now, if you go down the centuries, then you'll see that by the time you reach the 1600, so that was the century of Galileo and Kepler. Okay, so there you see that still the number of stars known were just about 1,000. Right? Tycho Brahe also 1,000, Flamsteed had 4,000. So then, where did the extra star come from? Why is this? One moment. Yes. So you see that Galileo started using a telescope around 1600, and that made a tremendous difference in how faint you could go and the number of stars that you could see. And there, if you look at the catalog of Tycho Brahe, which still had 1,000 stars, because he was using an eye catalog, but you see that the accuracy had improved because the use of certain instruments, and that went to about 100 arc seconds, meaning a tenfold improvement in the accuracy. Then the next great advance came with the invention of photography. So new techniques, new data. Right, and there you see that the number of stars suddenly went up. So you've got 26,000 stars in this Argelander catalog. And then what is the accuracy of measurement? 1 arc second. So at that time, even though you had a telescope, you did not have really good measuring instruments of them. And then when you look through the telescope, you're still dependent on your eye. So the advance after that, after the telescope, was photography, where you see coming in 1850 or so. And then came the electronics and the electronic measurements and the CCDs, and the number kept going up very, very rapidly. So if you come to the 20th century, 21st century, the 20th century rather, then there was a satellite called Hipparchus, which was launched, which was named after Hipparchus, with whom the story started in this picture. And so the Hipparchus catalog had 120,000 stars with an accuracy of about 1 milliarcsecond. Right? So you see that you are going from 10 to the 3 arcseconds to 10 to the minus 6 arcseconds. So in 2200 years, you had improved the measuring accuracy by a factor of 10 to the 6. And that was approximately also the increase in the number of stars in the catalog. So the Tycho catalog, which also came from the Hipparchus Observatory, had a million sources. The next one, of course, is Gaia. And Gaia is already been in the sky for a few years. It is making truly wonderful measurements. And you are getting micro arc second accuracy in the positions. Okay, and then there are billions of stars in the galaxy. So that is the journey that we have had. Now the question is, did we really have to wait decades and centuries until the measurements became accurate enough to match what we have now in order to make new discoveries and make better and get better understanding of our universe? That is not true at all. So if you go back, if you go to the time of Hipparchus, and then you see there that using his catalog, he actually discovered the precession of the equinoxes. So you know that this is an extremely small effect. The Earth goes around in something like 26,000 years once, one round, and then which changes the position of the pole star in the sky. And then you see, but how did he discover it? How did he discover the small effect? Now for that, he had to go to catalogs which were made even earlier than his time. I believe he went back a couple of hundred years and then looked at the positions of the stars and marked them, and then understood that his positions were different from those. And then it doesn't mean that he had a wonderful idea of a spinning Earth and which goes round and so on, precesses. It is that he knew that this effect is there in the sky. Okay, that is an observationally discovered precession. But look at the amount of work you have to do for that. You have to collect these catalogs, which should be there on papyrus or whatever. Some of the catalogs also in people's heads. Okay, and then maybe they were in different languages. And we also use different languages now, and we are in great trouble about it, even when you look at computer languages. And then you see that they would have been in some obscure notation. you must understand that we did not have the present day number system at that time. And then you had to use obscure number systems, okay, and then combine all the catalog together. So you see, it would have taken him many years to do this work. He had just 1,000 stars in his catalog, and as far as he was concerned, that was big data. Okay, and he was processing it to the best of his ability to discover these wonderful observational facts about the night sky. Right, so now if you look at Tycho Brahe, whom you see in the picture now, with his great success. So you'll see that Tycho Brahe had collected all the data. He was a wonderful observer. And then he came across a young person approached him and started working with him as a research assistant, what we call a research assistant now. And his name was Kepler, Johannes Kepler. So Tycho Brahe, I believe, I mean, this is all, I mean, I don't have the exact thing for it, but I've read somewhere that he believed, he understood that Kepler is truly an extraordinary person. And then he wanted to give him some data to analyze. And he gave him the data on the position of Mars in the night sky. Over the years, the position keeps changing. And right now, in fact, this morning, there was a wonderful right angle triangle with the moon, with the moon, Jupiter and Saturn at the vertices, and along one arm was located Mars. Okay, that's a truly wonderful sight, except that you have to get up in the 5 o'clock in the morning to see it nicely. You could also get up earlier, anytime after 1 o'clock, and you see it in the morning. And then, so now the orbit of Mars had been plotted over a very long period of time. Apparently, Kepler was given that data simply because Tycho believed that this data was so difficult that Kepler would not be able to make much out of it. So he wanted to teach him a lesson, apparently. But on the other hand, Kepler, this data was the only complete data set. And so Kepler worked on it, and then he discovered the laws of planetary motion. Okay, so you see that was a very great advance. And then when Newton, a century later, developed his law of gravitation and the calculus which was necessary to apply to planetary motion, and then Newton could derive Kepler's laws from the very first natural law which had then been discovered, the law of gravitation. So here is a picture of Kepler, and here is a picture of his one. So then when you see that all these centuries now, in our present time, we are in a mad rush to invent and develop new kinds of telescopes. We are not confined to the visible part of the electromagnetic spectrum. For the last several decades, we have been working on radio astronomy and X-ray astronomy and gamma ray astronomy, and now gravitational wave astronomy. So each one of these astronomies have either have been discovered by accident or by design, and that they are required the development of completely new facts. So even though astronomers work so rapidly and the data comes in, there are always new facts to be discovered. All right. So I had to keep moving things on my screen to be able to see it. So you see that here, I'm going to show you, this is a diagram based on another diagram first given to me by Dipankar Bhattacharya. So you see that at the left-hand side of the left-hand upper part of the diagram, you see a large yellow circle which says 10 to the 11 galaxies. So what do you mean by 10 raised to 11 galaxies? Now these are the galaxies which are in principle visible to us in the universe. Now does this mean that the universe is finite? Then once you counted the 10 to the 11 galaxies, there will be nothing left in it? That is not true. The universe could very well be infinitely large. There could be an infinite number of galaxies in it. But the point is that in order to see more and more galaxies, I'll have to go to vast distances in the universe, because there are not too many in our own neighborhood. As I go to greater and greater distances, the light reaching me now has left that part of the universe where it came from earlier and earlier. So by the time I count about 10 raised to 11 galaxies, what will happen is that I would have reached an epoch in the universe through which light would not be able to reach me. Okay, so which means that I'm going to the earliest epochs of the universe. So which means that as far as I'm sitting here on Earth, but I could be sitting anywhere at all in the universe, the max number of galaxies that I could spot is about 10 to the 11, of which about 100 million are already in our data sets, and about a billion are used in routinely or not so routine. And you understand that each galaxy is practically a world in itself. I don't understand why this is not working. Okay. It is amazingly slow for some reason because I'm sharing the screen, I think. So now to the right, in the upper right part of the picture, you will see stars. And so now each of these 10 to the 11 galaxies has about 10 to the 10 or 10 to the 11 stars. So you can say that we have that there are about 10 to the 21 to 10 to the 22 stars that we could account for. And then there are about 10 to the 10 of them in the data, and about 100 million is the kind of star that
Ajit, you have been muted, I guess. You have to unmute yourself.
Muted accidentally. Right, so we first started with the notion of 9 planets. People have been looking at more planets but not finding them. Then there were, then Pluto was demoted to a non-planet, and then a minor planet. And then we started discovering planets around other stars, starting in 1995. So we know about between 1,000 and 10,000, several thousand planets now, and we believe that there should be at least one, but many planets associated with every star. So if you've got 10 to the 21 stars, you're talking of 10 to the 22 planets. So you see that what we know now is we are just skimming the surface. It is not even the tip of the iceberg. Okay, it is probably just a handful of molecules from the top of the tip that we are looking at. So now the universe is not like a crystal. It's not like exactly the same thing sitting there, exactly the planet is the same. There's a very great variety. And what we need to know, what we need to do, is to try to investigate that variety. Now the point is that, well, look at the way you discover patients who have COVID-19. I mean, we keep hearing about all the time. So imagine that you carried out a random survey of a population just to see how much the disease has spread. You have to work very, very, very hard because the number of people who actually have COVID, either in an asymptomatic form or in an apparent form, is very small, very minuscule. It's just a percent or so, even less than that of the population. On the other hand, what happens is that you start looking for people who have some kind of an abnormality, okay, who are coughing, who are a fever, or whatever. And if you test those people, or people who have been in contact with confirmed patients, and then you are more likely to find more people with the disease. So here too, it is the same. What happens is that there are lots and lots and lots of objects which are not interesting simply because there are so many of them and we already studied them. But by looking at them, you establish a general pattern. And then by developing new methods, new technologies, you'd like to put your finger on the unusual objects. So astronomers always love to discover unusual objects because then you see some new truth. Now, many years ago, when I was developing techniques for the virtual observatory, Shivrani Tirupati, who is presently at the Indian Institute of Astrophysics, she came to Ayuka for a short time as a postdoctoral fellow. And I said that, could you, she's a specialist on stars. I knew nothing about stars. So I said that, could you please try to apply virtual observatory techniques to stars and try to find something new. She came back to me 2 weeks later and said she had discovered a new kind of an object, which is a particular, I believe it was an M-type subdwarf star, and only one other such object was known in the whole galaxy at that time. So she had found an extremely rare object by looking at unusual patterns. And then even now, there I believe there are only about four of those known. So you see that we need to develop technology in order to find, discover the rare objects which are quite different from the normal, and that is where we will make interesting new discoveries. All right. So now here, I've got a slide on Hubble's law, but I won't talk about it because I'm going to be talking about it quite a lot in my lecture on precision in astronomy. So here I just want to make a passing reference to a technique, discovery technique, which is being used now, with which I'm sure many of you must be familiar, and that is called citizen science discovery. So the idea there is that we have lots and lots of data. In particular, let's say that we have lots and lots of images of the sky, which cover large areas of the sky. And we want to now find, we'll look for unusual objects there. And there's a finite number of astronomers looking at an infinite amount of data. So how do we bring in new people? Now, we cannot just multiply the number of astronomers because that is a long and agonizing process. And if you have too many of them, then you don't know what to do with them after they get their PhD, for example. Right, so therefore, can we involve the general population? There's a large number of people who are interested in astronomy, who would like to do amateur astronomy, but can we harness them to do useful work in a very systematic way? Now, that is known as citizen science because it goes much beyond astronomy, and it has been developed into a very fine art form, or rather science form now, and it is leading to wonderful new discoveries which would not have been made otherwise. And so here in this slide, you see this thing which is known as Hennis Furwerp. Okay, it's a Dutch word, I imagine. And so which is a very crazy kind of object. So citizen science is becoming very important for making such discoveries. All right. Now after this, what are the charms of astronomical big data? Okay, meaning that if I have lots and lots of data, so we are going to go from the 1,000 stars which Hipparchus had to 1,000 stars which Hipparchus had to petabytes of data now. I want to go back to my previous slide. I wonder why it didn't work as normal. Yeah. So what are the charms of astronomical data? Is that one is that most data is freely available and easily accessible. Right? What do you mean by that? You try to get certain kinds of biological data or chemical data, you'll find that that is not easily, not accessible. And that is because it has many implications. It has got commercial implications and so on and so forth. In astronomy, we are free of those blemishes. And then astronomers are always used to distributing data freely, and then they develop available technology. So when we first started IUCA, then I got in touch with the Astronomical Data Center in Strasbourg and asked me to send their data holding. And they put about 15 large format tapes in a cardboard box and sent it to me, which arrived after a long time. And it took about a year to read that data. Now, you could just now access all the data in the CDS with the internet and get, in fact, download everything that they have quite quickly. So we use whatever technology is available. Then data and image analysis facilities and VO tools are available in abundance. So let's say that tomorrow you get interested in X-ray astronomy. You'll find that there are, so long as you have your notions correct, you know your physics and astronomy, you could learn the X-ray data analysis very, very fast. And you could just ask your fellow faculty or your students or postdocs, or you could just get onto the internet, look at all the processing software that is freely available, and begin to work in X-ray astronomy in just a few weeks' time. It might take you years to become an expert, but the beginning can be made very fast. Then once you analyze the data, once you have got the data in a form in which it can be analyzed, okay, then there's great opportunity for applying statistical analysis and machine learning tools. These are available all over the place, and you can again become familiar with quite soon in such a way that starting from zero, in about a year's time, it's quite possible for you working perfectly on your own, completely on your own, to develop new insights and write useful research papers. So that is the power of astronomical data. So what are the problems with astronomical data? I mean, this is just the other side of the coin, which is why I showed a coin there. And it says that the obsession with archives, I mean, you can simply get obsessed with using archives. You can write papers very fast. And typically, as you become better and better and faster, the quality of your papers will go down because you're doing the same thing again and again. I think you're simply not interested in new observations, new techniques, because you're quite comfortable with what you learned. And then worse than that, then you ask why develop new telescopes? Why join a team which will develop new telescopes? It'll take them 15 years to do it. I'm quite happy with my archival data. Then clearly, I mean, I just imagine if everybody did it. Well, Aryabhatta wrote about his ideas in 21 slokas. It took the next 1,000 years to analyze them and learn from them. Right? But then it was finished. So if we stuck just to his 21 stanzas, then we wouldn't 121 stanzas, then we wouldn't have got very far. So you always need new telescopes, new instruments, and new ideas. Okay, so we have to take risks, and we have to get out of this. But keeping these negative factors in mind, our thing now is to how do I make, what is the data available, how do I gather the data in the 21st century, and how will I use the data most usefully? Right. So just to see that not everything is lost, and we'll see what are the facilities which are becoming available in India now. There are existing facilities which I mentioned, but new facilities. Okay, so now this is not quite new. I mean, 5 years old now, launched in 2015, AstroSat. I'm sure that all of you have heard endlessly about it through this course of lectures. I'm not going to be talking much about it, just a couple of slides. So this is AstroSat. Okay, then other important mission which is going to go out, it says next 5 years, but I think now it's the next 2 years, is the Aditya L1 mission, where a solar telescope, a space-based solar telescope, will be launched and put at the first Lagrangian point. And now this telescope, so this mission will have several telescopes, one of which is being built here in Ayuka, and Durgesh Tripathi and Ram Prakash are the lead investigators. Right? And then over the next decade, I mean, so you're having the really big instruments. So you'll have the TMT, the 30-meter telescope, your LIGO India, and then you'll have the Square Kilometer Array. Now, India, as you may know, is an important player in all these projects. We are 10% owners of the TMT, and then we are installing a full LIGO detector here in North Maharashtra and Northwest Maharashtra, and the NCRA and other institutions in India are very important players in the Square Kilometer Array. Right, so there is no danger, at least for 10 or 20 years, of our losing contact with new telescopes and new instruments. Now, I really will not talk much about AstroSat here, because then it has detectors. You can see pictures of some of them, the UV, all of them. In fact, you've got the UVIT at the upper right and LAX PC upper left. the soft X-ray telescope, the lower left, the monitor, the sky survey monitor, and then CZTI. Well, so here is the one of the early things which are discovered to people's great happiness, which are the gamma ray bursts, right? And most importantly for us here is the data pipeline, right? So you see that the data comes, arrives on the Earth, and is detected there during the passage of the satellite over the ground-based ground station in a very primitive form. And then it has to be analyzed, it has been, the pipelines available for it. And then the data is distributed. It is basically sent to the raw data is processed at the five centers where the which are the PIs for the five instruments. And in IUCA, for example, we receive the CZTI data in collaboration with TIFR. But there are wonderful pipelines there for analyzing the data. Right, so now this data is not very voluminous. Let me see if I return it out. Yeah. So over the over a year, we'll be collecting about 200 terabytes of data, because this data not only includes the data which reaches the Earth from space, but that has to be analyzed in many different ways. That has to be processed in many different ways, and which is what takes it to about 200 terabytes per year. And over the lifetime of the satellite, it will be more than a petabyte. So that is the volume of the data. All right. So now here is another great Indian project, which is the Giant Meter Radio Telescope. And in normal times, you would have come to IUCA, and then you would have been taken to the telescope site. You would have seen it, and then but that's not possible in the normal times. And this telescope is run, operated by the National Center for Radio Astrophysics, who also built the telescope, Goit Swarup, and you must have heard of him. And then the NCRA belongs to the Tata Institute, the center of the Tata Institute of Fundamental Research. All right. So, this consists of an array of 30 parabolic reflectors, each one of which is 45 meters in diameter, spread over a baseline of 25 kilometers. I mean, you know all these things, I'm sure. There have been wonderful lectures of them. And recently, it has been upgraded a couple of years ago to what is known as the UGMR, the upgraded GMR. Okay, so, and how much data does the GMRT collect? So you see that here, you've got, there's what is called interferometric data. Right, meaning that the GMRT is an interferometer, because there are so many antennae, signals from which are combined together in phase. Okay, so that data, I mean, if you want to get an image of a galaxy, for example, or if you want to spot a quasar, then you use interferometric data. And that is about 4 terabytes per year for the GMRT. And then the pulsar timing data, and study of pulsars is a very big thing. And the pulsar timing data amounts to about 40 terabytes per year. So now that the UGMRT is getting the data, you're talking about 10 times the data volume. Okay, so which means about 400 terabytes of data coming in per year. And then you see that it is not as if the data has come in and you have used it and thrown it away. You have to keep it. You have to keep the data. You have to be able to access it very fast. You have to be able to combine it with data from all other telescopes in the world. Okay, so which are, yes, so here you see that, you see here before you a GMRT archives. This is not the current archive, this is a slightly older version. This archives was built using very nice technology for that time, about 10 years ago, I believe, from my virtual observatory project. It was done as a collaboration between people from the NCRA and people from working on the virtual observatory, which included people from IUCA and people from Persistent Systems. So this was, to my knowledge, the first archives of its kind in India. And what you could do was that you could just go and click on any source like this, and then you'd get all the available data on it. You'd be led to all the available data on it. And then you could also be led to the data which is available on on data on that source of X-ray telescopes, optical telescopes, or whatever. It is a truly wonderful way of doing science. The next big radio telescope, of course, there are pathfinders there, but this is the square kilometer array. So the square kilometer array is going to be in split between South Africa and Australia. The pathfinders have already been built. It'll get ready over the next few, the first antenna will be ready quite over a few years, and that project will go on and on and on. Now, all that I want to say here is the amount of data which will come for this project. Okay, so we are really talking about, you see that the GMRT produced about 40 terabytes of data per year. And the advanced GMRT will produce 400 terabytes of data per second, per year. And here, the SKA, there will be 45 terabytes per second of data exiting the correlators. Okay, so this raw data, you know that a year is 3 into 10 to the 7 seconds. So which means that the data rate, the data rate is about 3 to 10 to the 6 times of the GMRT, new GMRT data rate. And then you'll have about 500 petabytes of archived data, which will require hexaflop computing. Right? So here you are in the big data league, but not really the same league as the data which is collected, for example, by Walmart every year. And the amount of data which goes into your Twitter messages and then your email messages and so forth. I've got slides which just say how much the data is, but I'm not showing them. All right. So now there are two ways in which you can collect astronomical data. Now, for example, if you look at the GMRT, you can point it at a specific source and observe that source at one or more frequencies, and then you do that for year after year and year, and then you build up an archive of, say, radio galaxies or quasars or whatever. Other way of doing it, and which are also followed by the GMRT, is to conduct a survey of the sky. That meaning that you say that I'll use the GMRT to just sweep the sky or a certain area of the sky, which could be the entire sky visible to the telescope, which is about half the total sky, or a patch of the sky. And then you'll say that, look, I will try to detect every object in patch of the sky. You can't detect literally every object. For example, you will not be able to detect objects with zero flux. So what you do that, I will detect every object which is brighter than a certain radio flux at a certain frequency. So that is called a complete survey, which is carried out over a well-defined area of the sky. So what's that wonderful survey, which has been going on for a long, long time, is the Sloan Digital Sky Survey. So this is not that... it is at optical visible wavelengths, and then it is done with a telescope which is about 2 meters in diameter. And then there's a large format CCD camera. When I first started using CCDs, they had 385 to 476 pixels. And then we had a total of 52 megabytes of disk, right? And so that was really big data for us. So now, here you are talking of large format CCDs, where each CCD is quite large, and then you make an array of these CCDs. Okay, and then you keep observing the sky over and over again. So this is a 2.5 meter telescope at the aperture point. And then what you do is that the way it observes, it is continuously sweeping the sky. And the way it observes is that as it is sweeping, you get an exposure. As it sweeps, you keep moving the pixels of the CCD also, right? So that the same pixel gets light from the same portion of the sky over a period of 53.9 seconds. And 54 seconds is more easy to remember. Okay, and the resolution that they get, that the point spread function is 1.3 arc seconds. Right, and this survey has been going on for a very long time. And there have been data releases here. So this shows the original intention of the survey to cover a part of the northern sky. And then these are the deeper sections. That's all changed now. And so how much data is available? This is in DR15. I forgot to look up whether the DR16 now, the data ring is 15. And it covers 14,555 square degrees of the sky. And there are total of 933 million detections, which correspond to 260 billion stars, 208 million galaxies, 4.1 billion spectra, and a total of 156 terabytes of imaging data. Then, of course, what you do is that you process these images and then you make catalogs out of these images. So let us say that you want to find out what is the, you want to select all stars in a small portion of the sky, which are brighter than, say, the 17th magnitude in the B band. Then you don't need to look at the image and then you analyze that image, and that will take forever. You just get into the SDSS catalog. There are all kinds of GUIs available for that. And then you put it in the web interface that you want such and such a thing. And then you'll get the data absolutely immediately. And if it is a fair amount of data, it means that there are a lot of objects that you want the software to search. It takes a bit of time. So you put it in as a job there, and then it takes a few hours. It searches for them, packs them into the in the format that you need, and sends it to you. As simple as that. And this has been a vast source of astronomical work. So you see, you may say 54 seconds, that's nothing. I mean, people observe for for hours at a time. So then what can I do with such a shallow survey? Okay, then you say that I got 10 meter telescopes. What can I do with 2.5 meter telescopes? So there are literally thousands of people making the living out of working on SDSS, and thousands of papers have been written. Okay, so it is a truly wonderful repository of astronomical observations. So where do we go from the SDSS? So what is it that we want? We want to carry out optical surveys, and then we want to detect many objects. And the idea would be then is to do that even with a bigger telescope. So you must understand that I got about 10 more minutes to go. All right. You must understand that we can't use the biggest telescopes in the world for a survey. Like when we built the 30 meter telescope, we are not going to use it for a survey. That is because it has got an incredibly small field of view. The bigger the size of the telescope, the smaller is the field of view. Okay, and then you really want to look very deep with that telescope. So what you do is that you build a smaller telescope. So in the old days, a 2.5 meter were terrifically large telescopes. But now that we are in the era of 10 meter class telescope, 2.5 meter is a small one. So there was use for this. But now we go to the next survey, which is the LSST, that the large-scale synoptic survey, and it's now called the Vera Rubin Observatory. Now it's a large synoptic sky telescope. Okay, so what is the size of the telescope? So you see that it is a 8.4 meter telescope. That is slightly bigger than the VLT telescope, which are among the biggest in the world now. So you are very ambitious. You want to build things. And then you have to follow up objects discovered by this telescope. And how do you do that? You are going to use the 30 meter telescope, and you are going to use the EELT and other such big telescopes to do that. Right? So you will cover 20,000 square degrees of the sky, and then you will be observing in six bands. But the magic comes out of this word which is known as synoptic. What does the synoptic meaning? That is something which is done again and again in time. And so what you do is that you see that the SDSS, there the telescope just sweeps the sky just once. It may come back to that part of the sky later for some specific purpose. But the idea is to make one image of the accessible sky. With a synoptic survey, what you do is that you sweep the same part of the sky again and again and again at different cadences, meaning that I could go to a telescope at part of the sky and go back there again after 10 minutes, after half an hour, after 3 hours, several times a night, come back after 15 days, come back after a month. And with these cadences, each part of the sky will be discovered, will be observed through 1,000 visitations over a 10-year period. And so why do we do that? Because that is how you discover the transients. Meaning that I observe a part of the sky and come back there after a few days. So then I might discover an object then which was not apparent 3 days ago or 15 days ago. And what kind of an object it could be? It is a transient, meaning it was not there before, it may not be there in the future, but it is there now. And it could very well be a supernova, for example, because supernovae keep going off all the time. It could be a variable star. It could be a gamma ray burst, and what you are seeing there is simply the optical emission from it. So the idea is that you discover many, many, many transients. And then you discover so many of them that you start making completely new discoveries. But then see what is involved in this, what kind of technology is involved in this, is that you go there and then you, you're getting an image of the sky, which will be fairly large. And then if you go there after some time, you'll get another image, and you have to be quickly analyze these images, subtract them one from the other, and see which are the objects which have come up. And the whole technology is developed in such a way that you'll actually be able to discover thousands and thousands of transients every night. Right? So that is a notion which takes some time to actually grasp. Okay, so I can say that, all right, you know what happens is this. If you discover supernovae with telescopes, then you want to follow them in some survey. And let's say that you get supernovae once in a way. Now, I am a supernova astronomer who would like to observe the supernova with a bigger telescope. The point is that as soon as I discover a new supernova, then I have to get telescope time. And on that day, somebody else will be using the telescope. So you have this notion of targets of opportunity, meaning that if something really, a really interesting transient is discovered, then the director of the observatory can stop the observations which are scheduled and turn the telescope to that point, because of the importance of the discovery. But then you see that this cannot be done all the time, that once in a way. But with the LSST, I know that I'm going to discover a large number of supernovae absolutely every night. So what I can do is that I can ask for telescope time in advance. Say telescope time booked on 17th of September in order to observe and follow some of the transients which will be discovered that night, because I'm absolutely sure that I'm going to get so many transients. So there's a completely new way of doing science. And what are the kind of key projects you can do with this? You've got dark energy, you've got galactic structure, and you have, of course, cosmology that you can do with it. But on the other hand, we'll also be able to make wonderful new discoveries in our own backyard, that the humble solar system. You also never lose sight of that. And what the amount of data that you collect? 15 terabytes per night. That's not very much compared to what the GF, what the SKA will do, but still it is a very great deal of data. Right, so if some of the organizers are listening to me, can I continue for another 5 minutes or will I stop here? Hello?
Hi, Ajit. So maybe we can take questions from here, because there will be another talk at 11:30.
Yes, I understand that. Perfect.
Yeah, thanks.
Okay? So it is 5 to 11 now, so I have stopped in time.
Okay. Perfect. Thanks.
I think Jun has a question. Nick, can you raise your hand? I can unmute you.
Hello, sir. Good morning. Am I audible?
Yes, I'm audible.
Okay. Thank you, sir. So my question is, you just said that the bigger telescopes result in less deep observations. So that's why we make smaller telescopes, which have a higher, which have a deeper observations. So could you please just elaborate on that point? Like, why does bigger telescopes result in less deeper observations?
Oh, deeper observations. What you mean by deeper observations is observing faint objects or faint parts of bigger objects. So let us say that we believe that a galaxy has got a certain extent, right? That is because that with a given telescope, I can observe it only to a certain faintness level. right? Because I'm collecting a certain number of photons per centimeter square per second, right? So then if I build a bigger telescope, then the object will have bigger diameter, and therefore the amount of light I collect will be much larger, and therefore the signal to noise will be much better for faint objects, and I'll be able to look at faint objects. So that is what is called going deeper into the sky.
Oh, thank you, sir. So just in case, can I have a second question, if possible?
Everything is possible as far as I'm concerned, but I don't know what the organizers think.
Yeah, go ahead. There are a few questions, not many.
Okay. So from the initial part of your presentation, sir, the Gaia telescope, which can get micro arc second accuracy to detect the stars. So could you please tell that how come Gaia telescope has so much precision apart from the others?
So much precision, right? Yeah, that's simply because you use the new technology. So what you do is that the Gaia is in space, and then it keeps making these observations. It does it repeatedly. And then you apply your trigonometric parallaxes, all sorts of things in order to get the position very precisely. Okay, so just look up something on Gaia and you'll see how that is done. You could also have asked another question. What do I do with this kind of accuracy? Why do I need it? Right, so if I want to measure the distance between, let us say, Pune and Bombay, I know that it is 192 kilometers. I mean, that is a reference distance which is used by the railways. Right, so now what do you mean by the distance in Pune and Bombay, from where to where? So if you say that the head post office in Pune to head post office in Bombay, that defines it better. But there is no reason for me to know that distance as accurately as centimeters, millimeters, or angstroms, right? So I need to know. So now if I look at the position of a star in the sky, Hipparchus had 1,000 arc second accuracy, and then with 1 milli arc second accuracy, and now we are talking of micro arc second accuracy. So do I really need to know that position so accurately, and what do I mean by position there? Because the star, unfortunately, it's not a point source. Because of the spreading of the atmosphere, it has got a finite size. So I have to define a point in the star for me to get this accuracy. So why do I need this accuracy? One simple reason. If there are planets around the star, then just as the planets go around, it is not that the planets will be going around the star. It is that the star and the planets will be going around the center of mass. So as just like the Earth moves around the sun, the sun moves around the Earth, or both of them move around the center of mass. And then you cannot see the planets because they're too faint, but you can see the motions of the stars. And the more accurately you measure the position of the stars, the more accurately you'll be able to see how it moves in the sky, and therefore you'll be able to discover planets around more and more distant stars. So that is the idea.
Okay. So our major point is to focus on the planets which is orbiting around the stars.
There are so many other things which can be done. But I'm saying that if you ask me to give one reason why I need such accuracy, that is the discovery of the planets.
Thanks.
There's a question from Sonia. Can you raise hand, please?
Yeah.
Sonia Ghosh. Okay, in the meanwhile, there is a question from YouTube by Tanishka. And the question is, how did we exactly come at the figure of 10 to the 11 galaxies?
10 to the 11 galaxies. You see, the point is that if I carry out a survey of the numbers of galaxies, which are done, what I do is that I take a small solid angle. Meaning that I take a patch of the sky. Let's say I take a circular patch of the sky. Then I can, in that patch of the sky, I can count the number of galaxies. Now those galaxies are not stuck to the night sky. You see, they are distributed all over. I mean, some of the galaxies are close by, some of the galaxies are further away. And I'm counting them all together. But if I count the galaxies, and also I know how far away they are, then I can see how galaxies are filling the volume of the universe. right? And then if I know that they're filling in the volume of the universe, and I know how far am I looking with my telescopes, and then I know the number density of galaxies per unit volume in the universe, but then I can estimate how many galaxies that I see. So it is not a sacred number, meaning that it is not exactly 10 to the 11. That gives you the order of magnitude of the galaxies that I can see. By the time I see 10 to the 11 galaxies, I'm so far away from us that point is so far away that I'll be actually looking at the early epochs of the universe. If I try to look even the earlier epochs, then the universe will be so hot at that point, everything, all kinds of problems coming in, so light will not be able to reach me at all. That is the point.
And Sonia's question was, what is a good source in concepts?
What is a?
And do astronomical observations. What is a good source for learning machine learning concepts with an application to astronomical observation?
A good source. You see that in the old days, I would have given you the names of three books and you would have said you don't have those books in your library or with yourself, but that would be the end of the matter. Okay, so now, of course, there are extremely good books, there are research papers, and there are all kinds of aids which are available and accessible very freely. So there are many different archives. Now, if you look at the Sloan Survey, what I would say is that just enter the Sloan Survey website. Okay, just type Sloan Survey in Google or whatever, and then you'll immediately get it. And then you'll find there are very nice explanations of what kind of data is available. Then there are examples available which show you how to start using the data. And these examples are available for, let's say, amateur astronomers or people who are in high school or college or advanced people. So you can just work your way through it. And it is very, very straightforward. All that you require is a bit of time and a bit of patience. And then you see that much of the data processing that you want to do can be carried out either on your simple laptops, because simple laptops are quite powerful, or that can even be carried out at the site of the data. Right? So there is really no resource crunch or literature crunch at the present time. Every astronomical research paper which has been published is freely available on the internet.
There's one last question from Arjun. Arjun, would you like to raise hand? Or you want me to read out your question? Okay, I'll read it. The question is, for graduate students, what opportunities are there for analyzing big data?
Now, when you say graduate student, you mean an undergraduate student, because they're the thing too. For different groups, a different thing. But are you talking of people who are doing their BSc, let us say? I suppose so. Okay. Now, yeah. So then I just answered a question. Now, for example, I mean, every source of big data also provides you typically the software for the analysis of the data. I would very strongly recommend that you begin with the Sloan Digital Sky Survey, because it has got really wonderful content for people with a big range of expertise, starting from zero and continuing to infinity. Right? So therefore, please look at that slide, and then you'll know how to do this, and then you can go to different sources of data.
Okay, that's all.
All right. Thank you very much.